honor to God, who is the head of my life. I'd like to say that I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord on this Easter morning. You see, he brought me from a mighty long way. That I could have been dead and gone, but I serve a good God. To Pastor Brooks, I thank you once again for giving me the opportunity to preach God's unadulterated message to my fellow co-laborers in the gospel and to you, my new Mount Moriah church family. I greet you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. See, it never ceases to amaze me how our God works. See, it never ceases to amaze me how God works. So make no mistake about it, I'm not worthy to be standing before you this morning, but God saw differently. Now, I won't be before you long, so if you have your Bibles with you, I'd like for you to open up your hearts to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting at verse 20. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting at verse 20. I'm just going to read a few of the following verses. When you found it, say amen.
Amen.
But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward, they that are Christ at his coming. Now, again, I won't be before you long. You can have a seat. I would like to use as a theme or title this morning, check, please.
All right.
Check, please. Now, if you could just turn to your neighbor and just look at your neighbor and say, I've been waiting since last Easter to sit next to you.
I've been waiting since last Easter to sit next to you.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, a quote from C.S. Lewis says, our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling about with drink and sex and ambition. When infinite joy is offered to us, like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in the slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a vacation on a cruise liner.
All right.
We are far too easily pleased. See, such was the case of the disciples after the death of Jesus. After his death, they lost their joy and went back to their jobs when they should have been standing on the precious promises of God. Today we're going to go through a couple of chapters of scripture from the Gospel of John that takes us from the crucifixion of Jesus to his resurrection from the grave. He lives. Our Savior lives. The death of Jesus Christ is important because he died to pay the penalty of our sins, but his resurrection is also important because it's proof of his victory over sin, death, and the grave. This wonderful truth gives the Christian joy even in the most challenging situations. The resurrection is proof that God the Father accepted his Son's offering for sin. It also gives us a glimpse of what's to come. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave is like a movie trailer that motivates us to get in line at the theater to see the whole movie. We begin our journey in John chapter 18, where we find Jesus taking his disciples to the Garden of Gethsemane. See, this was the place where Jesus frequently met with his disciples. Judas, the traitor, was aware of this and leads a group of heavily armed Roman soldiers and temple guards there to arrest Jesus. But Jesus, being God, knew everything that was going to happen to him and asked the soldiers, who are you looking for? When they answered Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus says, I am he. The Bible says, when Jesus said, I am he, they all fell to the ground. Let's pause for a second to, 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 Let me pause for a second and tell you that when God the Son took upon himself a body and came to earth to dwell among men, the Bible lets us know that his glory as God was veiled. There are those times, there are those few times when his glory as God the Son seeped out. This was one of those times. When Jesus said, "I am he," they were all knocked to the ground by the power of the great I am. Back in John chapter 18, we find Peter drawing his sword and cutting off the ear of the high priest's slave. All pandemonium was about to break loose when Jesus took charge and told Peter to put his sword back and then says to the Roman soldiers, "Leave them alone and take me." Jesus was arrested and taken to be interrogated by Annas, who was formerly the high priest but still had lots of power and influence. Annas questioned Jesus and then sent him to Caiaphas, Annas his son-in-law, who was the current high priest. The Old Testament teaches us that God made a donkey talk, and it appears that he was doing a similar thing when Jesus was with Caiaphas. Not even knowing what he was saying, from his own mouth, Caiaphas prophesied that Jesus would have to die.
Yeah.
He says, "It is expedient for you that one man should die for the people, that the whole nation perish not." Caiaphas didn't even know the significance of what he was saying.
Say that.
But what he said was true.
Uh-huh.
Jesus died so many could live.
Yeah.
And while Jesus was with Annas and Caiaphas, he was beat up by the soldiers, and in the morning they sent him to Pilate, who was the Roman governor over the province of Judah. By the way, where were the disciples? They were nowhere to be found except for Peter, who tried unsuccessfully to blend in with the crowd outside the court of the high priest. When Peter was identified as being one of Jesus' disciples, he denied even knowing Jesus. Jesus is now with Pilate, and Pilate interrogates him, asking if he was the king of the Jews. Jesus answers in John chapter 18, 36, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom belonged to this world, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish authorities. No, my kingdom does not belong here." After the interrogation, Pilate goes before the people and says, "I cannot find any reason to condemn him." Obviously, Pilate did his homework concerning Jesus. All he had to do was check the record of the Old Testament, and he would have known that Jesus was the Passover lamb who was without blemish. If he would have checked with the local reporter, he would have learned that Jesus himself said, "Can any of you prove me guilty of sin?" See, Jesus was without sin. He broke no laws. He was guilty of nothing but being the Son of God. But trying to keep a riot from breaking out, Pilate attempts to bargain with the people by offering to release a prisoner, as is the custom during the celebration of Passover. Pilate offers the crowd Jesus, but they say, "No, not him. We want Barabbas." See, this takes us to chapter 19 in John. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him whipped. Now, the Gospel of Luke tells us that Jesus was first brought before Pilate for trial. Again, Pilate was the governor of Roman Judea, where Jerusalem was located and where Jesus was arrested, so Jesus was brought before him. Pilate initially handed him over to Herod Antipas, in whose territory Jesus had been most active. But Herod Antipas sent him back to Pilate's court. Now, this probably occurred between verses 1 and 2 of John chapter 19. In John 19, 2, we find our Lord back in Pilate's court, experiencing the cruel mocking by the soldiers who made a crown out of thorns and put it on his head. Then they put a purple robe on him and came to him and said, "Long live the King of the Jews." And they went up and slapped him. Pilate appeals to the crowd once more, saying, "Look, I will bring him out here to let you see that I can't find any reason to condemn him." Pilate brings Jesus before the crowd, but when the chief priests and the temple guard saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said, "You take him then and crucify him. I find no reason to condemn him." But the crowd by this time demanded that Jesus be crucified because he claimed that he was the Son of God. Besides that, the law said it was blasphemy for Jesus to say he was equal with God. But the sad thing was, he was the Son of God, and he was equal to God. His words were honest and true. They just didn't believe him. See, hearing all this, Pilate became fearful. He was judging someone who claimed to be God. And also Pilate's wife had a terrible dream and warned her husband to have nothing to do with this innocent man. What Pilate hears is he tries to find a way to set Jesus free. But the crowd shouts back, if you set him free, that means you're not Caesar's friend. Anyone who claims to be a king is a rebel against the emperor. Matthew 27:24 tells us that when Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere with the crowd and uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. I am innocent of this man's blood, he said. It's your responsibility. And back in John 19:14, it says, Pilate says to the crowd, here is your king. The crowd repeats their demands for Jesus to be crucified. They cried out, away with him, crucify him. Pilate said to them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priest answered, we have no king but Caesar. All right. Then he delivers Jesus over to the crowd to be crucified. At the scene of the crucifixion, we find Jesus' mother Mary and others. The soldiers take spikes and nails Jesus to the cross. Now in John 19:31-37, we see more proof of the wickedness and hypocrisy of the religious leaders of the Jews. They didn't want Jesus' crucifixion to run over into their celebration of Passover. So they asked Pilate to hasten the death of the man who had been crucified by breaking their legs. Once their legs were broken, they would no longer be able to lift themselves up using their nail-pierced feet in order to breathe and would die by suffocation. So the soldiers went and broke the legs of the first man and then of the other man who had been crucified along with Jesus. When they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead. So they didn't break his legs. One of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear just to make sure that Jesus was dead and blood and water came out. This happened so that the Old Testament prophecy in Psalm 34:20 would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones would be broken. And they that shall look on him whom they shall look on him whom they pierced. And Joseph of Arimathea, a secret follower of Jesus, gets permission from Pilate to take down the body of Jesus. He and Nicodemus, another follower of Jesus, take about 100 pounds of spices, a mixture of myrrh and aloes, and wrap Jesus' body in linen cloths with the spices according to the Jewish custom of preparing the body for burial. They place the body of Jesus in a borrowed tomb where no one had been buried, since it was the day before the Sabbath, because the tomb was close by, they placed Jesus' body there. Amen. Have you ever been in a place in your life where you felt the bottom fall out? Amen. You ever been in a place in your life where all hope was lost? Yeah. See, this is where the disciples were. They had it all, with the exception of John, left the scene.
Yes, sir.
They had all went home. In fact, in John 21:3, we find Peter and some of the other disciples saying, Peter says to them, I'm going fishing. And the other disciples answered, we're going with you. All hope was lost. They thought Jesus was the Messiah who would right all the wrongs and deliver his people from Roman oppression. But they killed him. He was dead. It was over. See, this reminds me of the story of Buzz Aldrin, a man who participated in one of the greatest technological feats of the 20th century. He was one of the first two men to walk on the moon. Then something very unexpected happened. In just a few short years after his historic voyage, his life turned from success to disaster. Instead of basking in the glow of his heroic achievement, he sagged into a state of severe depression that nearly ruined him and his family. Buzz slid from the mountaintop of achievement to a valley of despair. He said, I had been immersed in just one project, going to the moon. I had gone to the moon. What possible goal could I add now? There simply wasn't one. And when the emptiness set in with no hope of ever finding purpose in life again, he became depressed. The disciples of Jesus experienced what no man has ever seen before. They experienced what no man has ever experienced. Since they saw the Lord heal and do miracles like turning water into wine and feeding thousands of people with only loaves of bread and fish. Once when Jesus sent the 70 out on a mission trip, they returned with joy saying, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. You see, they witnessed Jesus raise the widow's son from the dead. They saw Jesus raise Jairus' 12-year-old daughter from the dead. His disciples witnessed Lazarus, who had been stinking dead for 4 days, brought back to life. But now Jesus himself was dead. His disciples were helpless and hopeless and decided to go back to what they were doing before they met him. And today, lots of people become depressed. They reach their goals in life and find that there's nothing left to live for. Others slip into a state of depression when things they hoped for aren't reached and everything now seems lost. Some hope for someone to fall in love with and share a life with. Some hope for a successful career. Some hope for adequate funds to pay the bills. Men and women hope for reconciliation for a relationship that went sour. People hope for relief from stress. Some hope for something they dreamed about all their lives to come true. See, on the internet, you can find a page that lists 10 millionaire businessmen who committed suicide. The article says, the following men were all successful businessmen who committed suicide. The millions in their bank accounts did nothing to ease their suffering. This is where the disciples were. They had it all. They were handpicked by the Lord of life. They saw his miracles. They walked with the Messiah, but now they're saying to each other, he's dead. Jesus is dead. Let's go fishing. Let's look at John chapter 20, starting at verse 1. It says, the first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulchre. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter, and came first to the sepulchre. And he stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in. Then cometh Simon Peter following him, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lying, and the napkin that was about his head not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciple which came first to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. At first glance, the text, you see the word believe, and think that the disciple who reached the tomb first believed that Jesus had risen from the dead. No, he just believed the word of Mary, that the body of Jesus was missing. So as John examines the tomb, it's like he's saying, young Mary, it's just like you said, he ain't there. In fact, the writer tells us, the writer lets us know in verses 9 and 10 that none of the disciples believed that Jesus had risen from the dead. See, they still didn't understand the scripture that said that he must rise from death. Then the disciples went back home. Mary didn't believe. She thought someone stole the body of Jesus. That is, until Jesus appeared to her. Verse 11 says, but Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping, and as she wept, she stood down. She stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and seeth two angels in white sitting, the one at the head, and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, woman, why weepest thou? She said unto them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus said unto her, woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said unto him, sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said unto her, Mary. She turned herself and said unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus said unto her, touch me not, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren, and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things unto her. Can you imagine the excitement that must have come over Mary when she left the tomb after talking to Jesus? Can you imagine the joy that overcame her when all her fears were brushed away, and she now knows that her Savior was alive. See, I believe it was at this time that Mary believed all of Jesus' teachings, all of his prophecies about suffering and dying and raising from the dead hit home and were finally understood by her. Mary no longer saw Jesus merely as a good teacher and a miracle worker. She saw him as Savior and Redeemer and Messiah and God. The light turned on for Mary, and all the words that Jesus uttered while on the cross made sense. Father, forgive them. My God, why have you forsaken me? It is finished. The price for her sin was paid in full. She was forgiven. She was saved. Do you remember when Jesus saved you? Do you remember when you first saw the light? Do you remember when you first understood the gospel? All excited, Mary returns to where the disciples were staying, saying, I have seen the Lord. John 20 and 19 says, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saying unto them, peace be unto you. Now, could this be the state of many of our churches today? Jesus' disciples are gathered together behind closed doors. They worship behind closed doors. They learn the Bible behind closed doors. They fellowship behind closed doors. But the need is outside those doors. These walls, the people we're commissioned to reach are in our neighborhoods, on our jobs. The people we're called to reach are at the supermarkets and gas stations and the shopping malls. John 20 and 19 says, again, the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, when the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus to them, peace be unto you, as my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Jesus is sending his disciples by power of the Holy Ghost to make disciples. It's only through the authority of the gospel that people's sins are forgiven. When people obey the gospel, they're forgiven. If they reject the gospel, they're not forgiven. See, in the following verses, we see Thomas, he still doesn't believe, but when he finally believes, it says in verse 28, it says, my Lord and my God. Thomas answered him and said, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, do you believe because you see me? How happy, how blessed are those who believe without seeing. See, I'm glad that Jesus said, how happy, how blessed are those who believe without seeing. See, that's the power of the resurrection. Jesus is alive, and you didn't have to be living 2,000 years ago to benefit from him. He is risen. He's alive, and you can believe in him and walk in the joy of that belief without having been an eyewitness of the risen Savior. 1 Peter 1 and 8 says, although you have never seen Christ, you love him. You don't see him now, but you believe in him. You're extremely blessed with joy and praise that can, with joy that can praise that can hardly be expressed in words. What Jesus did over 2,000 years ago has an effect on your life today. 1 Corinthians 15 tells us that because Christ is risen, our preaching is not in vain. Our faith is not in vain. Our witness concerning Christ is not false. We're no longer in bondage to sin. Those who have died in Christ are not lost, but in his presence. Christians are not to be pitied, but are to be envied. Because Christ is risen, he will reign and put all his enemies under his feet, including sin and death. Sin is dethroned. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh death, where is thy sting? Oh grave, where is thy victory? Because Christ has risen, we who are in Christ will not be confined to these sin-cursed bodies, but will be given new, glorified bodies to live in a new heavenly environment where there is no more crying, sickness, death, or or sorrow, or crying, or pain. This corruptible shall put on incorruption, and when this mortal shall put on immortality. This is why we can rejoice, because he is risen. This is why the songwriter says, when I get weak and I can't go on, I feel all my hope, all my joy is gone. Late in the midnight hour, I talk to my God, and he gives me joy. Joy in my soul. Joy. Joy. God's great joy. Joy. Joy down in my soul. Sweet, beautiful, soul-saving joy. Joy. Joy in my soul. See, John 20:30 says, in his disciples' presence, Jesus performed many other miracles which are not written down in this book. But these have been written in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through your faith in him, you may have life. This is the purpose for which John recorded the words in this book, that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through your faith in him, you may have eternal life. Because of the resurrection, because you live spiritually, our sins have been forgiven, paid in full. The resurrection is the receipt that is proof that the price has been paid. Because of the resurrection, the Christian lives emotionally. God sent his Son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future. And life is worth living just because he lives. The resurrection gives our heart reason to rejoice. Because of the resurrection, the Christian lives physically. The Christian looks forward to life after the grave. Because he lives, we live. Do you know him today? Are you a recipient of this resurrection power? The resurrection is the receipt that the price for your sin has been paid. Do you want your receipt? Do you want your receipt? If so, then I need to hear somebody say, check please. Yeah. Check please. Yeah. Amen and God bless. Yeah.
Check please. Check please. I believe we all can identify with the fact that whenever you go out to a nice restaurant and you have yourself a good meal, and the waitress, the waiter comes over and said, can I get this for you? Thank you very much. Refresh my drink. Or can I have this, some more water, whatever? And after follow over, you're feeling pretty good. And what do you say? Check please. Check please. Amen. Amen. Didn't brother serve us a meal this morning? Amen. He served us a meal this morning. And now, because we're going to open the doors of the church, we're going to say, check please. Amen. Check please.
Should we rise to your feet at this time?
There is a name I love. I love his word. Doors of the church are open. If there's somebody in the sound of my voice, you get to know who Jesus is.